I've been fighting a cold. Well, I haven't been fighting a cold. I had a cold about a month ago, and for some reason, it won't leave me. And this morning, it decided to really come back. And for some reason, if I lose my voice in this sermon, I am sorry. So I guess that's good for you guys, because then that means it's done, I guess. I asked Paul to actually read the verses that I would normally be reading. And I want to do this different than just a sermon. If you look at scriptures, we're supposed to study God's word together and be taught and teach and all that. So I want to make this more of actually like a class than a sermon from the pulpit. So that's why I'm down here. So if you guys actually want to come closer, you can. If you don't feel comfortable coming closer, you don't have to. I'm afraid someone wants to get closer, so when I disagree, she can hit me. So it's your call where you are. You can ask questions, anything throughout this sermon we're going to do today. There's a bun in your view? Well, that's your bun. You can take care of that. Oh, boy. We already got a heckler. The first and second row on the right. So today we're going to be talking about goodness. We've been studying through the fruit of the Spirit and growing in Christ. And more specifically, what it means to actually have the Holy Spirit dwell within us. So I have a ton of verses today. I'm going to try to write them up here so you can follow along as Paul reads them and stuff. And there's even some Paul doesn't even have that I'm going to read. So we'll try to get through this. So Galatians 5:22 is where we're really going to be dwelling today. And we're going to be dwelling on this whole idea of goodness. So let's go ahead and read Galatians 5:22.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law.
That's a verse we've probably heard multiple times in the past 4 or 5 weeks and multiple years. But how often do we really stop and dissect that and actually look at all those pieces? Here the author of Paul is trying to describe something that is not a common thought to man. It'd be like me trying to describe what a horse is without actually having the word horse to say there's a horse over there. So if I was trying to describe a horse to Chad, I'd say there's a mammal over there. It's hairy. It's strong. It can work for me. It can give me pleasure. You see how that's similar here to what Paul's trying to do with the Holy Spirit? This, don't just take this as the Holy Spirit is peace and that's it. Don't just take it as the Holy Spirit is love and that's it. It is all these things in a full accord put together. And today we're going to really dissect the goodness part of it. I'll be honest, as I was reading through this and studying this, goodness, as I stopped and thought about it, you get along, you go, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Well, kindness is a lot like goodness, isn't it? Actually, no. Goodness is a complete entity of itself. And when you really start looking at the goodness word here and how it actually interacts with all the other words, it has its own place of uniqueness. And that's why Paul put in, you think, okay, if Paul was describing the Holy Spirit here, that by saying love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, self-control, wouldn't those all be good things? This is where you guys can say yes, no, yes. So why does Paul pull apart this individual word in itself of goodness? It has to do with the word itself, and we're going to really dive into that. There's a guy one time, he was at a Baptist convention. So if you're a Baptist, woohoo, go along here with me. But if you're not, it's still God's word. And so there's this guy by the name of Dr. Bates, and he was at this Baptist convention, and he got up and he made an amazing statement. He said, let me read it word for word. If God called his Holy Spirit out of the world, about 95% of what we are doing would go on and we would brag about it. Stop and think about that for a second. If God called his Holy Spirit home, about 95% of what the church is doing would continue to go on and we would go, yeah, look at what we were able to do. That's a shocking statement in and of itself. But then he goes on to says, what are you doing that you can't get done unless the power of God falls on your ministry? Thus, the power of God living inside you, propelling you, and driving you forward. Is that a true statement in itself? I want to see some head here. Yes? No? I got some nodding. I got some yeses. Do you recognize your ministry as being driven by the Holy Spirit? And with these elements right here that Paul's talking about in Galatians 5:22, do you wake up each morning putting on the armor of God, as Chad talked about, and you look at yourself going, God, how can I use love today? How can I use peace? How can I use goodness? How can I use faithfulness? That's a hard thing. I'll be honest. A lot of times I wake up in the morning, I'm like, okay, where's my donut? Where's the keys? Where's the car? I don't think about how can I go to work and love on my coworkers? How can I be patient with that coworker that hates me and won't work with me? How can I show kindness and self-control when someone says something to me that I don't disagree with, or my wife? How can I do those and minister to the world around me? We really need to hold on to that 5% that truly is not capable of being done without the Holy Spirit. And like I said, we're going to be dwelling on goodness today. So let's pray. Father, thank you for today, that we can come into your house, a building that you have blessed us with, Lord, as a body, a group of believers that's coming together that have been united by your Son's death, burial, and resurrection, and has blessed us with the Holy Spirit dwelling with inside us, Lord. Lord, help us to seize that Spirit and be able to use it, and Lord, force us to use it so that we can be a light into this world and show the glory of your Son to a nation and a world that's fallen. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. So let's read that Galatians 5:22 again there, Paul.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law.
So this goodness side here, if you stop and you think about it, how many here have tried to talk to somebody about Jesus Christ and try to witness to them? What's normally the first thing they say on them getting to heaven? I am a good person. I don't know how many times I've had that conversation with one of my friends. I can think of five in particular. I hit them up about every 3 years, and it's always, I am a good person. The problem is what the world defines as good is not what God defines as good. Let's be very clear. How would you define a good person? And the world's view is the outward expression of what they are, how they interact with those around us, how many times they do the dishes for their wives, how many times they mow the yard and are a good neighbor, that aspect. But God's goodness is completely not an external aspect, it is an internal aspect. And the problem is, in goodness of itself, a person, if they think, I can be good and get to heaven, the problem is they will never measure up. They don't even make it on the scale in comparison to God's goodness. I got some verses here that Paul does not have. Psalms 114, 1 through 3 says this. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupted. They have committed abominable deeds. There is no one who does good. The Lord has looked down from heaven upon the sons of men to see if there are any who understand, who seek after God. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupted. There is no one who does good, not even one. So let's lay the foundation here. None of us are good. Can we admit that? That's a hard thing to say about yourself. But you got to really acknowledge who you are. Because if you can't acknowledge who you are, then you don't know where you're going. You got to get that foundation of where you are in Christ first and with God. James talks about this a little bit more. If you flip over to James 4:17, it says, therefore, to the one who knows the right thing to do and does not do it, to him is sin. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short. We're all not good. And then Romans 3:12, we actually were talking about this a little bit in today's Sunday school class. There is no one who does good. There is not even one. And that's actually referring back to that Psalms passage I read earlier. So let's get the foundation. Let's get the very basics here. If you cannot accept the fact that you are not a good person, I suggest you have a good conversation with God before you leave this building. None of us are good. None. I'll be honest, as I give this sermon, it kind of feels like a downer. I left here last night after giving this sermon, I'm going, that wasn't very encouraging, Chris. But we got to accept the facts for what it is. We're broken. We're falling short. we are nowhere close to what God wants us to be. And thus, the world thinks they aren't broken, that they are good, and they can get to heaven. It's not true. So let's go in and actually define what goodness is, and specifically this word. So the most common time you'll see goodness or good written is the Greek word kalos. Now, this is an outward expression. This is the outward. So when I say I have a good horse, this would be that expression, or I have a good car, I have a good wife, things like that. That is that expression. It is an outward appearance, or is something that's useful to me that is good. It's an external aspect. It's not an internal aspect. Another way it's translated is better, fair, good, worthy. But those aren't actually the goodness that Paul's talking about here. If you break this word down that Paul's talking about here, it's agathos. Is actually, it's, I think I spelled that wrong. I can't even spell Greek right. We'll change that to an O and a U. There you go, agathos. That's the root word of this meaning. And it's actually only used four times in all scripture. Paul's the only one that ever uses it. He uses it here in Galatians. He uses it in Romans. He uses it in Thessalonians. And then he also uses it in Ephesians. This goodness is completely different. So if the kalos is the outward expression, what do you think agathos is? Inward. It is this idea of something inside you that makes you good, not what you do outside of you that makes you good. Does that make sense? Does anybody want to add to, take away, or agree with? That's where the Holy Spirit side is. See, think about it. We are a corrupt, ungood being in of ourselves, but the moment God places this Holy Spirit that Paul is trying to describe here with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control, that is what makes us good. It is nothing of my own flesh and my own soul that makes me good. It is the Holy Spirit living within my soul that thus makes me good. That is really what's going on here. And when you look at these verses, let's break them down a little bit more. So, Paul, can you read Romans 15:14? We're going to read through all the times Paul uses this word, even Paul back there. So,
and concerning you, my brethren, I myself am convinced that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and able also to admonish one another.
So Paul here is making this statement saying you are good. But who is good? Who is these people that Paul's talking about that are good? He says, you yourselves are full of goodness. Well, who are you? Let's go back a little bit earlier in the verses, back in verses 1 and 3 of that same chapter, and Paul says this.
Now we who are strong ought to bear the weakness of those without strength and not just please ourselves. Each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me.
He's making this parallel with these people to Jesus. And then in verse 13, he ties it in even stronger yet.
Now may God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
The only reason these people are able to be good is because of why? The last two words there. The Holy Spirit. I'm going to hammer on that a lot because I don't want you to leave here and think that you can be good in any other way. Let's go on to the next time Paul uses this in Ephesians 5:9.
For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth.
So this fruit of the light, a lot of times you can take that fruit of the light and translate it as fruit of the Spirit. Because what makes someone a light to the world? Having the Spirit inside of them that has been given to them by Jesus Christ. If you go back to the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:6, I believe, when he's talking about being light into the world and all that, let your light shine. That is the idea of letting the Holy Spirit shine from within you out. Be the vessel that is being carried. Not the actual lamp, but the light itself. We're just a lamp holding the ability to God igniting a fire within us. But that light is the Spirit. And verse 7 and 8 actually talk about this more. And more specifically, that whole chapter in Ephesians 5 is talking about being imitators of God's children. Being imitators that are God's children. Children in God. 2 Thessalonians 1:11 is the next place that's used in the scripture. And this is kind of a different place Paul's using it here. Paul starts off all of his books by giving a big greeting, kind of. You guys have seen that? We went through scripture where it's a big conversation. And so in it, he goes and he starts saying to them these statements. And then in verse 1:11, it says,
"To this end also we pray for you always, that our God will count you worthy of your calling and fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith with power."
He's supposed to fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith with power. Those two are tied together. They are not separate. The goodness and the faith, they're tied together by a conjunction that we would say is and. And then if you read the next verse, it goes on more and says why these are tied together in verse 12.
"So that the name of our Lord Jesus will be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ."
So why is it glorified? Because we are in Jesus. Exactly right. I'll go back again to every morning you wake up. Do you identify yourself as being in Jesus Christ? Do you identify yourself as being in Jesus Christ when you go have lunch? Come home from work, or dealing with that grandchild that is like my 4-year-old sometimes. We are in Christ, so thus we need to be made a new creation like him. And then rolling back to Galatians 5:22, it talks about where we are today with the fruit of the Spirit. And thus is describing the whole aspect of the Holy Spirit. That's what all Paul's doing here in chapter 5. He is trying to lay a foundation to the Galatians, saying, here's what the Spirit is. It's something foreign to us. Think about it. At this time, did the Holy Spirit dwell in people? Not prior to after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And in Acts, we see that take place. Prior to that, the Holy Spirit would come and go. But we are on a completely different side of the fence where it is a person that has taken a residency within us the moment we accept Christ. And so now Paul is trying to scrape, how do you interact with this person who you are now joined to? Every person in here who has probably gotten married has learned that you have to act a little different when you're married. And be a little bit of a different person, right? Because you are bound to somebody else. You are identified by whom you are with. Hopefully someone good, and hopefully likewise you are being identified good by them because you are good and you are loving and you are enjoyable. Yeah, that can hit home real quick. Abby, no comments, please. But Galatians 5:16-17 and prior says, "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh." That is the vessel. That is that candle. That is what we are part of. We can't get rid of this flesh right here, right? We live in a mortal world. We have this flesh. It's what makes us alive. Someday we'll be able to shed that. But right now, there's this battle going on between our flesh and the Holy Spirit inside of us. And Paul's saying here, walk by the Spirit. Ignore the flesh. Push the flesh aside. For the flesh sets its desire against the Holy Spirit. For these are in opposite to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. It's interesting that in every one of these four verses that Paul talks about goodness, you always see the Holy Spirit either before or after it, and also this idea of a children of God by having the Holy Spirit. Jesus talks about this more in Luke 6:43-45. Paul, please.
"For there is no good tree which produces bad fruit, nor, on the other hand, a bad tree which produces good fruit. For each tree is known by its own fruit. For men do not gather figs from thorns, nor do they pick grapes from a briar bush. The good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth what is good, and the evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth what is evil. For his mouth speaks from that which fills his heart.
So let's be very honest here. What fills our heart? I want some answers here. What fills our heart? Sorry, what did you say? Love. Hopefully that's what's filling our heart. I want the good and the bad. So what else fills our hearts? I'm making you guys think besides listen. Envy. Jealousy. Kindness. Pride. Pride is evil. Joy. There's a lot of stuff that can fill our heart. And we have listed both the good and the bad, the evil and the desirable from God. But God's desire is for us to be a tree that brings forth what kind of fruit? Good fruit. So I have a beehive at home. And actually yesterday I broke into it because I needed to do some work on it. And so beehives are a lot of times referred to as a body. Right? Right, Chad? And I was thinking about that as I'm taking apart this body, a hive, taking apart, taking care of it. And I started thinking, I was like, what makes a hive body good? It's having a good queen. Something inside of it that's ruling it, that's producing good seed so that they can go out and create a good harvest back in the hive. If you have a bad queen, she will lay in spots she's not supposed to lay. She may not lay at all. She may lay all just male drones that can't do anything besides eat all the food and get in trouble. How do you get rid of a bad queen? How do you get rid of the badness? You go in, take that body apart, and you kill her. What will happen to that hive, though? If you kill that queen, one of two things will happen. Either that hive body will completely die, or it'll produce another bad queen in itself. The third way you actually make that hive good is you implant a good queen. Isn't that what Jesus did with us the moment we accept him? We were this body, this hive that had a bad queen living inside of us, our own desires, stuff that was functioning and alive, but really wasn't doing anything good and productive. And then the Holy Spirit came in, crushed that old self, hopefully, and thus made itself the queen in our life. It's interesting that God gives us so many analogies in nature about whom we are before him. The hard part is to recognize the fact that we have that old queen in us. And also recognize the fact that sometimes those old workers, they still want to work for that old queen. They won't accept the new queen. And you actually have to be very careful when you put a new queen in it, because the old workers will come in and they'll try to kill that new queen. So you got to protect her and give her guidance and direction and strength so that she can thus change the whole hive from within. And you want to know how she does that? She starts laying eggs in the good spot. She starts producing good young, good fruit that can thus make the body better. It's a good analogy of what the Holy Spirit does within us. Sometimes, though, we don't want to accept that new queen. So where does this come from? We've really hit on that it comes from God. The Holy Spirit is a part of God. So you got God, you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And because God is good all the time, God is good. So thus, all three in and of themselves is goodness. Not this outward expression of goodness, but this eternal aspect of goodness, the essence of itself of goodness. So let's look at some examples of goodness. So when I was trying to work on this sermon, I'm like, okay, God, we got goodness here. Let's find some people of the Bible who are really good people. You know, it's hard to find that. Why? Let's go back to Psalms where it says no one's good. And you know where I started looking? Children's books. All right, children's books. How do we teach our children about what is good? And one of the first persons that came up was Joseph. Think about it. Joseph was a good person. Back in Genesis, you have Joseph here who is a boy at the time that his brothers sold him into slavery. But Joseph, wanting to serve God and not man, does good by being a good servant to his masters of this earth, respecting the authority of this earth. If you have a problem with that, I suggest you go read Romans 12. First two verses will knock you on your tail if you have a problem with authority in today's world. Joseph recognizes this authority, but he does good by it by worshiping God through his actions. And thus, through that, being a good man, because God has blessed them internally by recognizing who he is before God, he thus is able to actually eventually rule and have dominion over a large group of people. And then here at the end of Genesis, Joseph has this conversation with his brothers who threw him into slavery. And this is what it says, Paul, please.
As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about the present result, to preserve many people alive.
So let's be very clear here. God took this bad thing, this evil thing that Joseph's brothers did, but through the goodness of God living in Joseph, he thus was able to save thousands of people because of Joseph. This doesn't give any excuse for us to do bad, right? Bad is bad. Evil is evil. Slavery is bad. Which just, so some people say, well, if God's so good, why don't we just keep sinning and doing bad, and then God's goodness will overcome it, and then we got, no, it's, that's not how it works. Let's be very honest. Psalms 136, please, 1.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting.
And then Psalms 119, 68. This is a verse that we really need to take to heart. It's a very simple verse. I encourage you to memorize this. So Psalms 119, 68, please.
You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes.
We've already braked out the fact that God is good and God does good. But what are we supposed to do because of that? What's the Psalms going to say here? We are to do good through his statutes. We got to recognize the fact, because we serve a good God, a God that is holy. Thus, we in ourselves need to seek to do what his desire is, his statutes, and his holiness. So where do we first see goodness? So if you actually, you don't make it very far in the Bible when you actually get into finding something good, right? Think about it, all the way back in Genesis 1, you got God creating the world. Here he's going about and he's creating all these things, and he's saying they are good. We got light. After that, he makes the comment that it was good. He separates darkness from light. That's good. He creates birds of the air and creatures of the sea. He says that's good. There's a lot of things here that God is saying is good, is good, is good. And then he gets down to the last thing, and he creates man and woman, Adam and Eve, places this in the world, and then he says, what about them? That this is very good. Why do you think it was very good? What's God's ultimate desire for us? To worship him. I like that answer. And how do you worship someone? You have a relationship with someone. You interact with someone. God's desire is for us to have a relationship. It's like Chad and I, if we got to be, we're friends, right? I hope we're friends, right, Chad?
Yep.
You're being the bunny of the day that I'm picking on. So hopefully we're friends. Now, what maintains our friendship?
We communicate.
We communicate, like we're doing right now, right? We have this interaction back and forth. Is there any boundary now between Chad and I? No. So you would say this relationship is hopefully fairly open and very good, hopefully. That's what God's desire was for all of his creation, was that it would have a relationship, a fellowship with him that was very good. Prior to this time, there is no evil in the world, so this whole bad side of man doesn't exist. It's only because man does what? He gets a wife and thus has problems. But the man himself actually was a bad wife or bad husband. The man was a bad husband. Let's just flat say that. Guys, it's our job to make sure the bad stuff stays out of our house. And that's not what Adam did. Very simple. So thus, now we have this fallen world. So now this this very good relationship, this interaction back and forth, is now being severed by sin. God's desire is for us to have a very good relationship with him, one where we can commune together without any barriers or anything. The next person you run into scripture that I'm going to use here is actually Enoch. Think about Enoch. He was a man. He was actually the great grandfather of Noah. Do you guys realize that? There wasn't that many years between Enoch and Noah. Actually, I'd say not that many years. There's hundreds of years. But in the scheme of things, it wasn't that long. Enoch was not a young man when he died. Well, did he die? No, he never died. What's this say about him? Paul, please.
Then Enoch walked with God 3 years after he became the father of Methuselah.
I'm going to back up here. That's actually my mistake. That's supposed to be 300 years.
Okay.
Yep.
Because 300 years.
At 300 years, he became a dad, not 3 years. Let's make that very clear here. Sorry, go ahead.
And he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him.
There's an old joke that says that Enoch and God just started walking and having a conversation, an intimate fellowship with each other, that eventually it got to the point Enoch's like, well, I need to go home. And God says, nope, why don't you just come with me today? It's a long ways back home. Isn't that our desire, to eventually be able to walk with God so much that we are in his presence, so much that we become in his presence? Keep in mind, Enoch was 365 years old. No one here, I don't think, is 365 years old. I got about, 330 some years to go before I get there. But this was something that Enoch did daily. To walk with God implies the fact that he got up daily and made a choice to fellowship with God, to commune with God, to be with God, so that God's Spirit could dwell within him and thus change him. Keep in mind, Enoch lived in a very fallen world. Look at Noah. The world was so corrupt that God wiped it from the earth and only saved Noah's family. So I'm willing to bet Enoch had a lot of bad influences around him. But Enoch still chose to walk with God daily, to the point that God said, why don't you just come home with me? Hebrews 11 talks about this more in verse 5 through 6.
By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him up. For he attained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is rewarded, that he is a rewarder of those who seek him.
So how was it, or why was it that God took him? Because he was good and pleasing and walking with God. And it goes on there, it says, without faith it is impossible to please him. Enoch had such a strong faith, such a strong desire to serve God, and the strong desire to be in the goodness of God, and thus have that goodness overflow him, that it was pleasing to God. So let's jump to the New Testament here, to Jesus. He's probably the best example we have of goodness, right? Why? Well, he comes from God. That's very simple there. That would be the Sunday school answer for this morning. So in this goodness here, there's, you kind of get a glimpse of how good God, or how good Jesus is, actually at his baptism. And people go, well, why is baptism? Well, let's read this for a second here. Matthew 3, 16 through 17.
After being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
We have this well pleased part again here, the same as we did back in Enoch, don't we? And this love, this pleasureness, descended like a dove and light. Isn't that amazing? This would have been an amazing sight to see. It would have been something that probably would have been Well, that's different. I like the last part of there, what Jesus' dad says about his son. This is what every child probably desires their father to say to him. It says, "This is my beloved son," or for you ladies, "This is my beloved daughter, in whom I am well pleased." What makes a father say that? Because he sees the goodness in his child, sees them being a good contributor, something that is living and thus giving fruit. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, Paul talks about this even more here.
"For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that you would walk in them."
So why were we created in Christ Jesus? For his good works. God created his son, and thus we were created in his son through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. But then if you read on there, what's it say about God? It says, "which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them." God has plans for us in the future. From this moment on, God has plans for you to do good. He has set things in place so that you can do good and give glory to his name. Think back to Joseph. We talked about at the very beginning. God's desire was for him to do good and to give pleasure to his name. We're the exact same. Do we always seek those good desires? Well, hopefully if we have the Spirit inside of us, it becomes natural, and it's a natural fruit for us to seek those desires. Now, if you don't, maybe you need to have a self-revelation with God and see where you are with him. And a lot of this is more described in the fruit and the branches here, which Jesus talks about. Jesus is very clear about the good and the bad. And so Matthew 7, 17 through 20 talks about this good fruit, this bad fruit again. We've already talked about it once, but we're going to talk about it again here. In Matthew 7, 17.
"So every good tree bears good fruit, and the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then you will know them by their fruits."
So how are we known? By our fruits. Now, a lot of people will say, well, this fruit side is us actually saving more believers. I would argue that is a lie. I'll be honest with you. If you are working and doing God's kingdom, sharing these fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, does it say in there, new believers? No, that is not a fruit of the Spirit. These things will help bring people to God, but they are not the fruit in and of themselves. Let's make that very clear. Our desire, our ability to have good fruit is when we're in the good vine and the good branches here. What happens to the bad? What happens to the branch that produces bad fruit? What does Jesus say God's going to do? He's going to cut it off and throw it in the fire. Does that sound like a very good place to be as a branch? It'd make you shudder. It'd probably make you want to start producing good fruit. And how do you produce good fruit? You allow what's in you to actually flourishes or come to fruition and produce the fruit that is desire is actually created for. So there's actually some good parts, and I'm going to say bad parts in the worldly quote here, of actually doing the goodness of God in this world. So the goodness of God, if we actually look at it and we're doing the good things of God, this is where it goes back to Psalms 119:68, where it says, "God, you're good and you are so good, and thus because of that I am going to do your statutes." That's the good things, where we hold up the statutes of God and live a life that is, we can break it up in two verses here, loving God and loving others. Those are basically the two statutes of God in just two statements. So that's the good, the easy part of it. But let's break it down to where the world would see it as the bad side. If you are a good person, you are not swayed by the things of this world. Does that make it easy? No. It's hard sometimes to hold your ground, to speak truth in the situation and be a good person through the goodness of the Holy Spirit. Daniel here talks about this quite a bit, and he's a great example of that. And this is where we're rolling into kind of the application part of this sermon. And you stop and you look at Daniel. It's a fairly long book. And you have three of his friends who are thrown into a furnace at the very beginning of Daniel and come out unscathed and all that. And you have Daniel here who is worshiping and serving God. Did Daniel work in the church physically? No. What was Daniel's occupation? He was basically like a politician, if you think about it. He was a governor. His job was to rule over people. He worked in the secular world. He worked in the fleshly part of the world. Yet Daniel's desire was to serve God and serve God wholly. I'm willing to bet that there's times people came to him and go, hey, Daniel, let's do this and we can get by with it and make a lot of money. And Daniel said, no, that's not what my job is. I'm going to respect the authority of the people over me. I'm not going to undermine them. I'm going to be truthful to my word. I'm going to keep my word. How many politicians do you know today that keep their word? There's a few. And they actually are able to do that because if you look at them, they have the goodness of God living inside them and actually speaking truth into the situation. Thus, through Daniel being such a good integrity man, allowing the Spirit to live with inside him, allowing him to actually dwell with God and have fellowship with God, he was able to rule over basically the whole realm of that time in that region. And then we have some people that come to him and they really want to take him down. So let's read here Daniel chapter 6, verses 3 through 4.
Then this Daniel began distinguishing himself among the commissioners and satraps because he possessed an extraordinary spirit, and the king planned to appoint him over the entire kingdom. Then the commissioners and satraps began trying to find a group of accusations against Daniel in regard to government affairs, but they could find no ground of accusation or evidence of corruption, inasmuch as he was faithful, and no negligence or corruption was to be found in him.
He possessed, what does it say there? An extraordinary spirit. I don't know any other better way of saying what the Holy Spirit is. It is an extraordinary spirit. A spirit that is able to allow us to see God's desire, and thus, those around us can find no accusation or evidence of corruption. He was faithful. Nothing could be found wrong in them. Do your friends describe you the same way? Does your spouse describe you the same way? Or those that you know intimately, your friends close to you, or your children? Hits home. Let's be truthful here. The king then basically makes a decree that God, that he is a God and only people can pray to him. It's going back to that Sunday school lesson where little kids, I encourage you to read Daniel 6 and see how Daniel interacts here. But Daniel's not a young man. He is old in life. He is probably in his upper 80s at this time, 60 to 80s. So he is at the end of his life here physically on this earth. He can't start back over. Wouldn't that be kind of an easy thing to say, well, I'm old, I can kind of bend my knee here a little bit and get by this last few years and be good? Daniel doesn't. He stops and he makes a stand because he is faithful with an extraordinary spirit. He thus knows this decree is going to be passed. He actually probably even saw the king pass it, and thus we find out what Daniel does. Paul, please.
Now when Daniel knew that the document was signed, he entered his house. Now in his roof chamber he had windows open toward Jerusalem, and he continued kneeling on his knees three times a day, praying and giving thanks before his God, as he had been doing previously.
Daniel's attributes never changed throughout all this aspect. Daniel knew what was going to happen to him. Daniel didn't even mind to try to make any exceptions. He never closed his windows. He never stood in prayer. He never kept his words to his mouth. He did the exact same thing that he was doing prior because he was not influenced by the external attributes of the world because he was a good person filled with the goodness of God through his spirit. Can we be trusted to do the same? Makes it hard. I'll be honest, this world we live in is very, very easy to get corrupted by. The flesh part of here, that whole aspect here of what's happening around us. But we need to actually be having trust in God to serve God. We have a good story here. Daniel being actually thrown in the lion's den, not being devoured. So we have a good Sunday school lesson for us and little kids here. Is it still as good of a lesson even if Daniel was devoured by those lions? I would say yes. Because Daniel was a faithful man. He didn't give in to the things of this world. Even if he was devoured by those lions in that den, he thus still was a faithful man. His attributes, his character still were faithful. But God, through his goodness, showing his goodness of Daniel, was able to show who God truly was to all mankind. So can we be trusted to do the same? Even when it looks bleak in where we take our stance in this world, if we know we're biblically strong and correct with God and we're listening to the Spirit and we're pulling out all these attributes of the Holy Spirit here, the goodness, the love, the faithfulness, and all that, if we're allowing all that to actually dwell in us and actually give light to the world, it doesn't matter what happens to us fleshly. Because internally we have a new queen in our life that we're serving. Or better yet, a new king of Jesus Christ. Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, where we hit today, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such thing there is no law. Goodness overcomes evil always. The greatest example of that was Jesus Christ. Christ on the cross is the ultimate expression of the goodness of God. If you don't understand that, please talk to me afterwards. But more importantly, not just Jesus on the cross and his death, but the resurrection proves that the goodness of God is victorious. There's hope. There's reassurance. There's something to look forward to. Without the resurrection, we don't have any victory in Jesus Christ and in God. And that victory and that whole thing is because God is a good, good Father. There was once two guys who were at Niagara Whirlpools, and they were talking and having a conversation. They're two men, and one turned to the other and says, "You want to see the most powerful thing in the world?" And he goes, "Yeah." And the other friend says, "So." So they walk down to Niagara Falls, and he says, "See, there's the most powerful thing in the world. Watching this massive water cascade over this cliff, and just the strength and the beauty and the awe. I don't know if you guys have ever been up against a waterfall, but it just encompasses you. All your senses are craving what's happening before you." And the one friend turns to the other who just made that and says, "No, the greatest unused power in the world is the Holy Spirit of the living God." Let's not neglect that. Hopefully you go into your life, your ministry here on this earth, recognize the fact that you have the most powerful thing in the world that God has ever created living with inside you. Does that give us encouragement? Gives you goosebumps too. Hopefully you do it. So in those times of struggle, seek after God. Seek after his goodness. Because God is good all the time. All the time. God is good. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you that we could dive into your passages of scriptures and see that you are a good, good Father. A good Father whose Son came into this world and has saved us from our own depravity, our own sin, our own flaws, Lord. Thank you for bringing us back to a relationship of a very good relationship with you through your Son's death, burial, and resurrection. Lord, help us to recognize the fact that you have blessed upon us with the Holy Spirit, Lord. Help us to strive to seek after it, Lord, and just let it guide our hearts. You are a good, good Father, and we know that you are. But Lord, help us to live a life in full recognition of who you are and what your Son has done for us. It's in your Son's name we pray, Jesus Christ. Amen. I didn't think this part through. It's only good.